Okay, this is All Back to Mine, episode 2. My very special guest today is Lady Melza. Melza, there she is.
Hello.
How you doing?
Yeah, I'm good, thank you. Sat in my little shed in my very windy garden down in little Exeter.
I was going to say, so what's the weather doing down there? Is it proper storms? Or
last night was unbelievable. The rain was just, I didn't think it was going to stop. So, and I was a bit frightened for my garden and my roof. But it's been pretty hardcore. Today's not been too bad, but it's blowing a hooly now. So,
yeah, blowing a hooly, that's a good word. okay, well, I mean, my first question was going to be about Exeter, actually. So, tell us, you're based in Exeter. Tell us a little bit about the music scene in Exeter, if there's any cool record shops that anyone might want to visit when they're in Exeter, any cool music venues, things like that, really.
Okay. So I moved to Exeter first time in 97, I think it was. I grew up, as I think we've discussed before, in the middle of nowhere in Cornwall, but there were scenes that I kind of went to. And Exeter was like this huge city compared to kind of where I grew up. And then I moved away to London for a while. And then I came back in sort of 2006. And I started doing a radio show at the local arts centre called The Phoenix. It's Phonic FM. And that kind of became the pivotal point of sort of where we would all hang out and do gigs and things. So it's a touring point for a lot of bands and comedians and stuff throughout the country. So that's kind of our central hub, really.
And was that a vinyl radio show? Or was that digital?
No, it was digital. A lot of people did vinyl shows. I didn't do it. I know. Yeah.
Oh, it was so cool that back then, I guess.
Wow. I don't know. I had the option to do it, but I don't even know why I didn't do it, to be honest. We had a breakfast show and, yeah, it was me and my friend Lucy that used to do it. So, but they still have Phonic FM. It still runs. It's still a radio station, and they have some great people on there. The Phoenix is where bands come and play when they're on the road and doing their tours and stuff. So that's kind of the central hub. We've got a place called The Cavern in Exeter, which is a cavern, basically. It's dark and dingy and stinky and sweaty. Yeah. And, you know, I've seen Rancid there, the punk band. And, you know, then I've seen Ugly Duckling. So, you know, everybody has kind of played there. It's Muse, but, you know, when the up and coming, all those kind of bands have been through the cavern. Again, it's a stop off on the road when bands are touring and stuff. So it's a great venue. It really, unfortunately, had a fire. Probably about 5 years ago now, and it's been there for a very, very long time. So it's one of Exeter's very central, very important places in the music scene. But fortunately, it's come back to life now, and it's back again. But with COVID and stuff, all these places are just hanging on by their fingernails still.
Yeah, I mean, gigs are happening, obviously, which is a good start, and hopefully they'll carry on. You know, that's the main thing at the moment, but it's all good. Okay, so that's music venue. That sounds cool. And a quick hello to Scotty Boy and also 45 Finch, Adrian and Scotty there. Record shops then. Obviously, you know, we're talking 45s. What is there any cool record shops we need to check out for an extra time? No, well, none at all.
No, there is. We've got Rooster, basically, and the guy. Oh, I can't do him down in public. It's a real shame. The record shop is really cluttered. It's not a particularly pleasant environment to dig in. The guy is really miserable. Unfortunately, Boca came down. He was playing. It's called The Angel. Sorry, I should mention The Angel as well. That's like a real quite important venue as well.
I think Adrian Finch knows the guy who runs.
There we go. Yeah, I don't need to say. I think it's up for sale. I think he's had enough. But I think when you own a record shop locally, personally, if I had it, I would be getting to know my people. And I would, you know, get to know them to the point of going, phoning them and going, I've got this in, or I've got a bunch of 45s in, do you want to come and look through them? You're going to make money, you know, you're going to make money, and you keep everyone happy. And it's a, you know, it's an important place. So it's really, Exeter really lacks a good record shop. A new one has just opened, but I've not been yet. So, and I think it's quite indie. But I've not been, so I will when I can get there. It only opened a couple of weekends ago. But it's a real shame. Yeah, so Bocca came down, dug all day, took it to the till kind of thing, and then the guy overpriced because he cogged everything and basically said, well, this is what we're going to charge, and he was like, I've just done your job for you. So, you know, pissing off members of the community, that, you know, word of mouth and those sorts of things are quite important, is, you know, it's not so great. Unfortunately his reputation isn't great. And
45 Finch is talking about SPS records.
Well, yeah, I was just going to them. SPS is in Tynmouth, so that's run by a guy called Harry. And it's a brilliant record shop. Harry's so bloody good at what he does. It's just, you know, when I go to a record shop to have we're all of an age, aren't we? Let's be honest. And our knees aren't as good as they used to be. So Harry's got like kneeling pads and little stools that you can sit on, and
lovely,
really nice listening areas. And it's just, it's a really nice environment, you know? And I just think it's so important. Relationships are so important, you know, with people, and especially if you're trying to make money. And I don't mean that in an underhand sense that you just have relationships to make money out of people, but I think making good connections with people, you know, word of mouth. Then I took Maura from, she came down from London, she does Mobile Mondays up at the chip shop.
Yeah
I took her down there, and you know, those sorts of connections are really important, and she loved it, and it was a great shop. So yeah, Finchie, good shout, SPS every time.
Good evening to Matt Love in the chat. And what you're saying is right, because obviously I met you and Matt and a couple of the other 45 Kings and Queens when we went down to Bristol, and we were in Wanted Records, and it's quite a little narrow shop, but obviously you do have to get on your knees to sort of get to the boxes of 45s on the floor, and that's the same in quite a lot of record shops. And you know, anything that can be done to help that, maybe we need to take one of those pads that gardeners have.
That's what Harry's doing. I mean, you know, some people are probably going, well, that's the joy of digging, you know, get on your knees. And well, you know, I'm 45 next week, you'll just add. And I don't want to be uncomfortable. I want to dig in comfort.
No. you need a bit of space to be able to sort of flick through the records as well. Talking of 45, so the whole premise of this show, all back to mine, is imagining if I came to your shed, your garden room, I don't know what you call it, and you basically said, right, here's 7 sevens that I've got, and basically play them to me. So you've picked out 7, and you've got a cool little portable PTO1 scratch, which is very cool. Do you want to tell us do you want to play it and then tell us about it, or do you want to tell us about it first and then play it?
I'll probably, like I said earlier, I'm crap with briefs, so I'll say one thing and do another. I'll just talk. Do you want me to do them just in a succession and chat?
Just do one for now, and then we'll have a chat, and then I've got a couple more. You know, I'll have a question in between each one.
Okay, cool. Well, basically, there's nothing groundbreaking here. There's nothing that, you know, you're going to go, wow, you know, I really need that on 7. And selecting,
you never know.
I doubt it. No, I know for a fact. You know, selecting them, this isn't a selection of my favorite 7s, because I don't think there is. And oh God, there's going to be a lot of cliches coming out. But I think when you're in a certain mood and a headspace, there's different music that you kind of feel. But these are pretty important to me, and they're generally always in close proximity. So okay, I'm going to start with this one. And so I've got lights in my eyes and I can't actually see.
Even if double P.
Hey, Paul. My life
twilight in the sunshine. Everybody loves the sunshine. Sunshine.
So you get the gist.
That is a tune.
So, yeah, I mean, there's not much I need to say about that. It came out in 76, which was obviously a great year because I was born that year. So.
Exactly. Oh, we were talking about, I was talking about this with Sideshow last time, and it's amazing how we're still playing records that are as old as us, and some are even older. You know, yeah. That's, you know, I mean, I've got some, you know, 45s from the 50s and some from the 60s, and it's amazing that we're playing music that is older than us, and it's still amazing, you know. It
blows me away when I guess this just happens with age, and you do like what you like. And you know, there are some modern artists that I do listen to that kind of give me chills and I think, wow. But you play something like that and I'm, you know, you don't, it's rare that you feel what you feel when you put that on, you know. Yeah. In the sunshine.
And also it's one of those tracks that, you know, is, there's lots of versions of it and lots of reversions. And as Double P's mentioned, Jim Sharp's version is killer, you know. And it, again, it goes back to how good a song is if people keep reversioning it.
Absolutely.
And it's still being re-released, you know, 40, 50 years later.
That's amazing as the edits are. You know, I love Jim's edit. I play it. You know, the original for me is it's killer. Absolute killer. So yeah, it's not an original 45, unfortunately. It's a repress, but
that's okay.
Right,
next question. Obviously when I saw you down in Bristol, that was for a hip-hop event, and I know you like your hip-hop, so what is it about hip-hop that you really like, and you know, which artists do you particularly like collecting or playing?
I'm stuck in the 80s, very early 90s era of hip-hop. I'm quite stuck in my ways in what I like, really. I think I've bored people with the story, but Caveman was basically my major introduction to hip hop. My friend's brother was a hip hop DJ and he did me a tape, and I was just like, what, you know, it's the drums that I heard and the break, and it just got me. It was Fry You Like Fish, and yeah. I was just like, what is this sound? So then I spoke to him and hassled him and explored more, and you know, kind of looked into other artists and stuff. And you know, then you had, when I was at school, you know, the likes of like De La Soul and Tribe and Jungle Brothers and Brand Nubian, and you know, all of that stuff that kind of coming. And I don't know. It just got me. It just absolutely got me. And I mean, the thing that amazes me about hip hop is I still hear things, and I'm still learning about the samples and stuff and where things have originated from. I mean, the sampling stuff is incredible, and it fascinates me how you can build a track from that. And you know, then you've got something like, you know, Roy Ayres, a track, and it's just, you know, the bass line of that is taken and then put into something that's hip hop. So yeah, the likes of Caveman, Big Daddy Kane, Lax, and I love playing all that. And I've never felt more white or middle aged when I drop a proper hip hop set like that.
Really, there's nothing wrong with that. I mean, DJ Misbehavior, I think, you know, before she played on one of the 45 Queens things a little while ago. Yeah. And, obviously I'd caught her from her viral video from a few years ago. And again, people were like, oh, he's this white woman playing this amazing hip hop. But
yeah,
it's just a fun. But I think it is a golden age, because back then you could get away with sampling basically anything. And that's why the tracks are so amazing, because they are sampling anything. Whereas now it's a lot harder, a lot more expensive. And
yeah,
you know, you just don't get the level, you know, something like, you know, De La Soul, you know, 3 Feet High and Rising and all the rest of it, all the samples on that would just make it extortionately expensive, and they just wouldn't be able to do it.
The one common thing I've kind of, when I really thought about it earlier, is Marley Marl. So his production, so anything really with hit that he touches, I love.
Cool. So have you got another track, and have you got a hip hop track, or is that a...
I can do a hip hop track. Yeah, I've got.
Let's do a little segue into a hip hop track.
Okay, this is. Oh, I hate saying this is one of my favorites, but I guess yeah, it is one of my favorites, and it's on a Japanese press as well, which is lovely.
Oh, fancy!
I know, fancy pants. It's the sickest hip hop track, actually. Sip the juice, not enough to go around. And the thought takes place uptown. I grew up on a sidewalk while on street talk, and then talk to all from York. I go to Queens from Queens to get the food from Brooklyn. Take money in Manhattan and never been token. Go uptown to the Bronx and boogie down the strong on the island. So, yeah, no, 91, I think that was 91. I don't know if it's got it on it,
but it, yeah, like, I mean, like Sucker Punch, I was about to say the same thing. It still sounds fresh, and it still sounds amazing, you know.
Yeah.
And the, you know, I guess there's probably an element of the vintage equipment they were using. Well, vintage in 91, but compared to, you know, it wouldn't have been necessarily computers like most modern music is sort of put through now. But yeah. Matt saying, never heard you play that before. I assume that's a joke.
Just because you haven't got it on 45.
Japanese press, Matt. Discogs Rush. Go find it.
Good luck with that.
Yeah, that was great. And Double P saying DJ Format was selling 45s at Swindon. Lady Melza was straight in.
I'm his best customer. Yeah. And the worst is when he plays his for sale box.
Was Mr. Thing selling 45s at that?
He was, yes. Yeah, but yeah. Like mega buck stuff.
Expensive. Which of course
I never drop mega bucks on record.
No. You should, like, I think I was telling you, you know, next time you're over down this way, Hastings, go and see Mr. Thing at his shop. You've got lots of great stuff. 45 Finch is saying Ghostface Killer does a version 2, which is pretty good. And Double P saying, thankfully, he had no cash on him when Format was selling. So, but Double P was telling us he's reduced his spending from £300 to £299 a month.
Oh, well done. Good.
Is what he was telling us last week, yeah. But that was before the VAT and everything else kicks in.
So I don't even acknowledge. So
no, I think you're just trying to avoid looking at the bank balance. Where
I'm trying to upload my get everything on COGS so that I can then export the spreadsheet out so that I've got insurance purposes there. And
yeah,
it's frightening.
Very good idea.
And I'm early. I've not been collecting 45s that long either. So yeah.
It quickly adds up, though. That's the problem.
Yeah.
It does quickly add up. 45s, then. So, obviously, you haven't been collecting for that long. So, when did you start collecting? And what do you like about 45s?
So, hardcore collecting, I started about 4 years ago. Three and a half, four years ago.
Yeah.
And I've always bought the odd one. So, I had a small selection, but I'd always bought 12s, really. I don't know what is it about 40. I get ribbed all the time by a lot of my friends that play 12s, and they're like, you know, you spend all that money and that's all you get. I like using them. I like playing on them. I find them easy to use. I just enjoy it. I enjoy it. It's
surely
nice.
Sure, it's quality, not quantity. Sure.
Absolutely. Well, they can jog on. They're just jealous that they haven't got it on 45.
they are fun. I mean, for me, I like that there's generally one song on one side and one song on the other side. So, you know, you're not spending.
It's easy.
I have done 12s and I've done digital and I've done all the rest of it. And I remember I did a 12 set for DJ D in Australia. I think some of the other people in the chat have probably done that as well.
Yeah.
But as soon as I started doing that, I was like, oh, right, I've got to find the track and I've got to find, you know, it's this track and then get it. You know, this is a 45, you know, you're going to put it on at the beginning, you know, roll it through and then it's there. You know, it's...
I find them really cumbersome 12s now to use. It's quite awkward. So, yeah, I'm just... And I mean, I learnt properly not that I can really DJ properly, but I learned really on my 45s more so than my 12s. But, you know, I'd play them at home, but yeah.
Exactly. And they are a lot more fun. So what's your third choice? What have you got for us?
Third choice. This is my favourite Nina Simone song.
It's going to be good.
I don't really need to worry. Might not be for everyone.
On a marble stand, trying to find the ocean, looking everywhere.
Yeah, again, you just don't hear stuff like that made now, really.
Amazing tune, beautiful tune. Yeah.
She was a troubled soul, you know. She had a troubled, like a lot of the artists, especially the black artists that came from that era, you know, they did a lot of horrible, horrible stuff. And I guess that comes through in their writing and their music and their song, you know.
Well, I mean, we've moved on, certainly, but it's very different times that they lived in, and obviously, you know, having to deal with a lot, you know, a lot of racism, and obviously we can't even imagine, you know, what they sort of went through. Amazing singer, an amazing song.
Yeah, you know, she was and I've heard that she was actually quite a nasty woman, but you know, I think our experiences and hell that sometimes we go creates who we are, you know. Yeah. Whether she was or not, you know, that aside, her music is phenomenal, and there's no one ever like her, and I don't think there ever will be again.
No, I don't think so. Double P bought a massive collection of 45s recently, and that was in it, so he now has that in his collection.
Oh, that was a good find, because that's not a cheap 45. It's not mega, but it's,
I think they bought something like 1,500 between them, 45s for
tunes.
100 quid or 120 quid or something like that. So, yeah, I'm waiting for that to happen. I keep looking on Marketplace. It hasn't quite happened for me just yet, but I'm sure it will do. But it's not like I haven't got many other records.
Yeah.
Next then, Twitch. So, like most of us, you've done the sets on Twitch. So, what has Twitch meant to you? How has it helped, you know, get through the sort of last year and a half? And for anyone out there who isn't yet streaming, any tips for sort of getting on and doing streaming?
So Twitch, 80 quid now, blimey. Twitch has been brilliant. I think Twitch has been a really great thing. So my old crew that I was in, we started doing weekly sessions, and we'd all kind of jump in and do a turn, and it's just, yeah, it's been great, and it's opened up, I think it opened up a world for creative people that were really struggling to both chat, meet and listen to music, and it's been amazing. And to switch on and to be able to see, you know, someone a bit crap like me to, you know, thing or you, of course, Criztoz, or, you know, the phenomenal people that there are that we both know, you know, it's been lovely. And it is, again, it's all cliches, isn't it, but it's a really nice community. And I just think it's great. I've spoken to some people that are quite anti it, and I think there's quite a few DJs that have been anti it, and that's cool. But for me, it's been lovely, and it is what it is. It's a thing. With regards to kind of getting online, I mean, the whole, I'm okay technically. I'm not amazing, but I can figure stuff out generally, is just make sure that you get your setup right and do your sound checks. And Twitch is glitchy, so sometimes you'll log on and there'll be no sound, and literally it can just be a log back out, log back on again thing. But just make enough time to do a sound check and make sure that you check that you're all working okay. Make sure you know how to raid. The whole raid thing used to terrify me. Literally, I mean, I still cock it up from time to time, but yeah, there's ways that you can do it, but you get used to it. What I do now is I will copy and paste the person's name, and I will have it stored on a Word sheet.
Yeah,
and then I will just literally copy and paste the whole raid thing, and then I can just click paste and it's in. As long as you've got the right address, it's fine. But no, it's been brilliant, and I've met incredible people that I've now got to meet in real life as well. And I don't think that would have happened quite as quickly or as much than without Twitch. So
there's a couple of bits with that I'll pick up on. But like Double P says, he puts it in his chat ready to go. Rating's a big part of Twitch, and I think it's for me, it's almost one of the most amazing things of it, that because, you know, before COVID and before that, you know, so not necessarily in the hip-hop scene or in the vinyl scene, but you heard about a lot of DJs sort of being, you know, being very egotistical and sort of, you know, not wanting to help each other out and trying to fight their way to the top. What Twitch I think showed me is that, you know, everyone wants everyone to succeed. You know, the fact that, you know, you go into a chat and you say, you know, hello to the DJ, and they say, oh, go and follow that DJ, go and follow this day, it's amazing. It's so positive. You know, it's not just saying, oh yeah, you're just here to watch me. It's like, no, you know, this guy's really good as well. That woman's really good, and she's a really good DJ, and he's a really good, you know. It's amazing. And I think the fact that, you know, a big channel, for example, someone like Sam Tweaks, you know, can have however many people and then raid to someone much smaller and then introduce those people to another DJ, I think is pretty amazing. And I think it's something that, you know, Mixcloud is missing at the moment. I've done a bit of streaming on Mixcloud, but I think the community element of that just isn't there yet. And it may be it'll come at some point, but they're still building.
Like anything, when you play out, if you've got people there, of course it builds your confidence and it helps you, and it makes you feel good because you're there and you can see that people are enjoying it. And likewise with Twitch, I've never gone to zero. Touch wood. There's still time.
I assume you've got it on your phone, so there's always going to be one person watching you.
You're absolutely watching yourself. Yeah. And my mum and all my local friends that I've made log in. I think I've gone down to like two or three, but it's gone back up quite quickly again. So sometimes if the chat goes a bit quiet, it can be, I do get a little bit, oh, you know, must do something to make them all talk. But
Matt's had zero, apparently.
Well, you know.
Matt, like I said, put it on your phone, so then there's at least one other person and it looks like it's someone else watching. It is, because we had this the other day, and I can't remember. I think it was someone, I can't remember who it was, but the chat sort of slows down, and it can feel a little bit like, well, you know, what's going on? But people consume Twitch a very differently, I think, to when they did at the beginning of the pandemic. You know, then people were sat in front of their computer. I know I was, you know, constantly watching, you know, interacting. Whereas now people sort of have it on. They listen or go to another room. For example, Fatwax has Sonos, however you pronounce it, and it's going through his house. And obviously he's not watching, but he's got the music in. And obviously he can hear, and every now and again he'll come out of lurk mode, put a comment in or whatever. So it's become a bit more of a background radio. Yeah, exactly.
And I'm saying, you know, if I know someone is on and I want to support them, I can't always necessarily listen. I've even had it on silent. I was in first aid training the other week, and I just I wanted to support, so I wanted to be there, and I could chat a little bit. But when I was learning,
that comes back to the community, doesn't it? You know, because, you know, you can't be, and it's like in real life, you can't go to every single gig. You know, say your mates are DJs, you can't go to every single gig they're playing. And you know.
I played that Crafty Cuts gig on Saturday night,
I can ask you about that. So yeah, that was my next question.
Sorry.
Go ahead. Go on. Tell us.
It was really good. You know, for me to be asked to do those things, I always feel so honoured and blessed, and I never feel good enough, really. It was really good. I mean, I got there, but I went on my own And I was at that, I was saying to Matt, I was like, oh, you know, and I was panicking about it and, you know, over worried because I do get worried about things. And I got there and there was a guy playing really heavy, really fast, really dark breaks. And I had a bag full of funk and hip hop, you know, coming in at like 90 BPM. So I was like, oh, and he was like, oh, you should have gone on first, really. And I was like, well, you know, I got booked to support Crafty Cuts, so, you know.
Yeah.
He said, oh, I'll slow it down for you. And he came down to about 140 BPM, which was nice of him.
Oh, that's nice of him.
No, it's good. So I just cut that and just, I came in. But it was good. But I knew people there, but I didn't go with anyone. And actually, I felt really a bit crap about that because I was just like, I'm on my own. And I wish I had my little crew here to big me up and give me that support. I'm really glad I did it and it was good, but I didn't love it. I didn't really enjoy it. And Crafty Cuts came and he shook my hand really officiously. And then he was like trying to plug all his stuff in around me. And then I was like, right, I'll go now. Thank you. So
I assume he was on two, maybe three, maybe four CDJs. Yeah.
I was on decks that were separated about 28 foot apart from each other. So I was like running to the other side to put the record on.
Well, weren't you the only vinyl DJ as well?
I was the only vinyl DJ, And I felt really awkward because I'd got there and the sound, the guy that runs the place, he's brilliant. He's a really lovely guy, but he's quite lapsadaisical and he's just like, yeah, whatever. So you've got to be quiet on the ball. So I kind of got there and I was like, the decks aren't on. They're not even plugged in. So I went out and the sound engineer came in. And he was like, no one told me you were playing vinyl. And I was like, oh, I'm really sorry. So you get really apologetic. And I'm like, oh, God, you know. So, but, you know, I'm really, you kind of have to do those gigs, don't you? You have to play those things and you have to be nervous. And I'm kind of all about pushing myself to do things that are outside my comfort zone. So
that's part of it. And, I've said this before on the show, you know, just the fact that we put ourselves out there on live, not TV, but it's almost like live TV, and we're just vulnerable and, you know, just playing music and you know, but you don't tend to get the good thing, you know, apart, there's been a lot of hate raids and things going on recently on Twitch that seems to have slowed down because we were getting sort of all crazy sort of people following us, but you don't tend to get a lot of bad feedback. I think Tommy T said it, people either come in and they like what you're doing and they'll tell you, or if they don't like what they're doing, they'll just go and find another channel. You know, you don't get people sort of saying, oh, you're shit, or, you know, oh, what a crap mix, or, you know, you don't tend to get that at all. Certainly I haven't found it in any of the streams I've watched. I mean,
I've dealt with negative people about Twitch, you know, making comments about people think they're superstars and stuff on Twitch. You know, I couldn't think of myself less as a superstar going on Twitch. Not that it was aimed at me, it's been aimed at other people, but if you don't like it, it's fine, just crack on.
Exactly. And we're still such a small niche. A couple of comments from people in the chat, and Double P, congrats, he's got his first live in real life gig coming up on the 20th of November. That's with Sam Tweaks and DJ Fade and Mr. Musto, and that's going to be fun. And again, you'll be nervous, Double P, but enjoy it. Just enjoy it, you know. And then Chris International, big up. He's going to be on the show in 2 weeks' time. I'm looking forward to speaking to him. And he says, for every uncomfortable gig, you get surprised with a great time once in a while.
Absolutely. And
Scotty Boy, a new granddaddy, but he says, you have to be nervous to put on a good show. I am every time and been doing it for over 40 years. And I think that's very true. As Matt Love says, nerves driven on. At the end of the day, you know, it was an opportunity. You had to do it, you know. And
absolutely.
You
and
don't turn that sort of thing down.
You know, you get to an age where you start to give less of a shit. You know, I still care. I still want it to be good. I still want people to like it. And, I mean, I came off stage and people stopped me and thanked me, which is really lovely. And for that, it was all worth it, you know. I was just feeling a bit sensitive because I was like, I've got no friends here. But that's just me being the sensitive little fool.
But it is, and when we've talked about it on some of the shows, you know, it's people assume because you're a DJ, you're this, everyone's, you know, confident and amazing that. And quite a lot of DJs are quite anxious, you know, and I know I get it quite a bit, you know, especially if I'm DJing on my own. It's just you sort of hide behind the decks playing your music and almost hope no one talks to you, you know, just so that you can just
That's why a lot of us do play the records, because we don't want to be out in amongst it all. I'm quite introverted, actually. I've always thought I was extrovert because I was always loved drama and music, and I always sung and was on the stage. Yeah. But as I've got older, I have realised I'm actually quite introverted. You know,
I think that's very true. I think I'm probably the same, actually.
Yeah.
I think we're on number four. Number four, is that right?
We are. Yes, we are. We're going to go here because I've got a. I love so much music. I couldn't even pin down one genre that I love. And this track just gets me. And I can't remember the first time I heard it, but it's scratchy and it's old, but it's beautiful. To take it off because I am going to start singing and that would just be terrible.
What you said, you were not doing any break dance. You didn't say you weren't going to sing.
No, there will be no dancing nor singing. You can't not be happy when you hear that. That's Alicia Myers is just incredible. And I mean, again, that whole disco to boogie era is just, I love it. I absolutely love it. And I've got to thank my friend Spider, who just absolutely inspires me. He's just incredible. He's an incredible disco DJ. And he's introduced me to so much stuff. And he's my friend and I feel so blessed. That's really cheesy, isn't it? I'm blessed.
Now we'll talk about that. Something to link to that in a minute, actually. A lot of love for that track in the chat. Big up Dinked Records, big up Kev.
Yay, Kev.
Matt Love says the Buster and Q-Tip version is immense. TT Funk says a tune. Scotty Boy, one of my fave sevens. I want to thank you. Top, top tune. Matt Love says that needs booting. And Scotty says the Con remix is killer.
Yeah.
Right, so obviously your friend you just said introduced you to lots of music. So how do you go about digging and finding music, both sort of before sort of COVID and obviously, you know, online digging and that? How do you find records?
I take Matt Love with me and he finds them for me.
I did see that in action myself. And actually, when we were in Wanted Records, he was picking stuff out for you. And then I was like, oh, have you got this one? And then I suddenly realised, hold on, I've fallen into this trap as well.
It's great. You know, on a very serious note, though, digging with people that is so lovely. Have you got this? Yeah, yeah. No, I haven't. Do you know this? Have you? That, to me, is amazing. I can't. You know, the whole Northern Soul scene of you know, secretive, and it's got to be, well, it can't be a boot. They've got cameras over the decks now, and you have to prove that it's an original press, and you know, obviously they'll hide it. And I get, you know, I get time that goes into digging. I respect that fully. You know, you've got people that go, you know, the guys that go to Utrecht and spend, you know, days and days upon days, and people like Thing and all those people that are, you know, are just a vinyl vulture. Psy travels the world, you know, through work, and the commitment that they put into digging is fine. I love it, but I've got to be comfortable. So I get, if I'm uncomfortable, it annoys me. I think with the, and again, this takes away from the origins of digging, but when you listen to a track, you've got things like YouTube. So you'll go, God, that track's amazing. So you'll listen to that that track, and then it will lead on to something else. And then you have a suggestion. So, you know, the online world has opened digging up. It's made it easier and more accessible. And I think, you know, and I'm still learning stuff, you know, I still didn't realize about things and what samples came from where. And, you know, you've got apps like Shazam, I know there's mixed feelings on that app, but you know, it's a phenomenal thing. Although it didn't work in oh God, what's his name? Whose shot were we in? In Bristol.
Friendly Records or Wanted?
Wanted, yeah, that didn't work in there very much. And then you've got, you know, Who Sampled, which is also like it's got kind of Shazam built into it. You know, it's just incredible. But yeah, going on a proper dig as well, it's great. Absolutely, yeah, every day is a lesson when it comes to digging. And you know, I love just popping into a charity shop and just flicking through generally a load of crap these days. But you know, you never know.
that's almost part of the fun, isn't it? You know, you walk into a charity shop and yes, there'll be, you know, a load of absolute rubbish, but then again there'll be a box at the back and you're like, oh okay, well, you know, I don't know this, but it could be interesting. And you know,
you pick a cover, and you, as you get to know labels and things that you know you like, you're potentially gonna bring something home. I know from a lot of hip hop, I found a lot of soul that I didn't know about because of obviously the samples used and, you know, incredible things like that. Massive Attack Blue Lines album, one of my all time favorite albums ever. You know, obviously it's just an album of samples basically, but it's phenomenal. And I learned about songs from that album, you know, so yeah, amazing. Tunes is serious. I mean, Matt Love, he's brilliant. He gets up and goes, he got up and went to a blimmin' car boot in Bristol. Came home with a load of vinyl for me, but you know, it's perfect.
Well, yeah, I mean, boot fairs are probably going to be less now in the winter, but maybe some inside. Yeah, I know boot sales is life. Yeah, yeah, you can. Again, it depends on the boot sale, and it depends who's there, and depends what's going on. But yeah, I mean, you know, anywhere you can buy records these days is brilliant, and you know, especially when they're 50p, 20p, a pound, it's just worth a shot, isn't it? You know.
Yeah, absolutely.
Right, I think number five.
Number five. Again, we're going into a very similar genre. This is rarely out of my box. I'm obsessed with female vocals, as some of you may or may not know. And this is up there for me. So again, you can't not love that tune. Well, I don't think you can anyway.
That's another great tune. And again, some love for it in the chat. And Scotty Boy says loves it, plays it all the time.
Here's
a record collector addict that we are in it. Not matter how many 12s and 45s I have, I can't stop buying this thing again.
I see it, I buy it. Yeah, no, that's definitely one that I will always buy. Yeah, when I see. Yeah, for sure. She's phenomenal, phenomenal voice. And again, you know, that whole disco boogie vibe, there's a DJ called Sadar Baha who he's just the Don in 45 world. He's incredible. And to watch him play. I don't know if he is, you know. I think he's too busy.
Well, maybe you need to get him on Twitch. Which leads me nicely onto my next question. DJ Coco.
Yes, I've warmed up for him.
So, I mean, obviously... I think I had a little bit advance warning from someone that it was going to happen, and obviously had to keep my mouth shut. But yeah, I mean, when it got properly announced that DJ Coco was, and obviously, you know, you'd organize that, I was like, wow, that is amazing. So tell us a little bit about that. You know, how did that come about? Did you speak to him? Did you speak to the manager? What happened?
I early days, because I used to organise the with my old crew the nights that we used to do, or the Twitch things we did. And I remember saying to one of them, sod it, I'm just going to contact Coco. And they laughed at me. And they went, ooh, you better learn to speak Japanese then. And I was like, oh, okay, whatever.
Google Translate. I did that with an Italian DJ. I was having to go through Google Translate, translating things and trying to work out what he was saying. But anyway, yeah, sorry, yeah. Karen.
Always double check, though, because I did that with some foster children that were from Afghanistan. And I double checked what I sent them afterwards. It wasn't correct. And I kind of got put back in my box on that one. And I thought, yeah, no, silly me. In fact, I think I said at that point, I said, you know what? I don't actually think I can bring much to the table on booking guests. I'm going to let the people that were doing it do it, because they've probably got more reach than I have. And then I put my big girl pants on and I thought, shut up, you idiot. And I may not have contacts, but I've got front and quite a lot of it.
Yeah.
So, there's no magical. It really wasn't that difficult. I reached out. And literally we did a lot of back and forth speaking to his manager, who was the loveliest bloke ever. And then partway through, I kind of went, oh, my God, I should just mention we don't have a budget. And they were like, yeah, we don't want any money. He doesn't want money. He'll do it. It's going to be it was a pre-record. It wasn't live.
Yeah, that's right.
But he did it specifically for us. It wasn't just And he was lovely, and I have messaged him and thanked him, and he's messaged me back. And we're now best friends, and he's going to fly me out, and the rest is history.
He's going to warm up for you in Japan.
He's going to warm up for me. Yeah. No, I don't think so. No, he's a man of very few words, but he did respond, and we have a very occasional back and forth. But no, again, you know, I mean, he's a machine, and to be honest, he's almost wasted on a crowd, because I always say he's a DJ's DJ. You do not know. It just sounds like he's so crisp and clear and pure and amazing and clean at what he does. You don't even know what he's doing. It just sounds like he's playing a record. So if you don't really know, I mean, I don't know that much about turntablism per se, but you know, some of the stuff he does is just, it's just incredible.
Well, I think that's the thing, you know, for us, obviously watching him, and Twitch is probably the perfect vehicle for it, because you can see what he's doing. So obviously, for the DJs who, you know, use that mixer, or for us playing 40, you know, just for us watching a god, you know, play 45s and thinking, well, how the hell has he done that? And then doing loop stuff. And, you know, whereas if you're not watching that and you're in a club and you're sort of, you know, two or three people back from the stage, you've got no idea what he's doing. It sounds amazing, but you know,
it's still an incredible show, because he's quite quirky. Obviously, he's only got his one eye and his dungarees, and he's you know, but it's insane. It blows me away. His skill is insane. And I mean, we were chatting as well, and you said that there's a few Japanese DJs that you're kind of keeping your eye on.
We had Tsuki Raider 310 played on Ace of Raids. I saw him on Shambra, and he played, and he really good. He played on Saturday, and again, really humble. You know, there was one point where he made a mistake and he just sort of joked about it, said, oh, well, you know, I've made a mistake, it doesn't matter, just carry on. And again, that's something with Twitch, it doesn't matter.
It's nice to see, actually, that kind of honesty about, I mean, I cock up all the time. I forget to put my disclaimer on, and I'm like, you know, but it's, I think that's important to know that, you know, we make mistakes. It's okay. Sometimes I will come off camera and I'll be like, I'll talk to myself and be like, you absolute dick, you know, and be really embarrassed. But then, it's okay.
Yeah. No, I did it the other day. I think there was something going on in the chat. I was chatting to Fat Wax and I completely forgot the record was finishing. I was just like, oh, well, no, it doesn't matter. T2 Funk, obviously Regulate Records, Regulate Recordings, sent him doubles of RO1. He was so appreciative in the message. I remember him doing a little session, and that's on YouTube as well. Why has that gone?
And I know it's his job and it's his career, but he does always seem to be very thankful of the records he gets sent, and he will always play them. He will always do them, and he will always mention them. And you know, that's great. That's what it's about, isn't it?
Yeah.
And he must get sent so much stuff, you know?
Yeah. Yeah, he's probably got bigger sheds than Sam Tweaks has got with just his promos.
Just about.
Yeah, that's cool. Okay, number six.
Number six.
You got two left, haven't you?
Yeah. Okay. Well, I'm going to go for again. This is a deep soul track, and the artist Marie Queenie Lyons. She didn't really do much. I was reading about her actually when you asked me to do this, and she disappeared. She was one of James Brown's backing ladies for a while, I think, but she kind of did some stuff and then just disappeared into the ether. Nobody knows what happens. But this track is the opening line is just, it moves me every time, and I just, yeah, her voice is lovely. So I will just shut up and put it on. So yeah, another, I like quite moving music, I think. I'm quite into, so the opening line, the only way I can get through the day is to make our life like it was yesterday. That's heavy.
That is heavy, yeah.
Yeah, and she's, just her voice and just that soul, you know, that whole, just, yeah, incredible.
Yeah, that's one I don't know, actually. I'll get you to send me that later, actually, or send me a link later on. A lot of love for that again. 45 Finch says it's a tune, and he thinks it's a blue sample. Mark Funk likes that, and also Matt Love says it's nice. So I'm going to say a big shout-out to Matt Love, actually, because he followed the channel today. I know he's recently had that, and he's become the 745th follower on Twitch. So that's 745. I like my numbers.
That's good.
That's cool. So yeah, so that's great. Thank you, Matt, for doing that.
I've got to have it. Okay.
I'm glad it's there's no prize. No prize. That's for another show, but I'm
that's a good number, 745.
Yeah. I think people think it's easy, but it's not. It's hard work, and you know, it's nice that it's repaying and sort of.
I think you're the hardest working man on Twitch.
I'd say I'm not quite. I'm sure Sam's on a lot more than I am.
Not necessarily on organizing. You do.
Oh, I see what you mean. Yeah.
And you have a young family, and you have a real intense job. So yeah, hats off to you. And thank. I'll just say thank you. And I think I can probably speak on behalf of others here. I'm just going to take over and say thank you for what you do for the community, Criztoz, because you do put a lot of effort in, and it is really, really appreciated. So, thank you for what you do. That's all right. Don't cry.
No, I'm not going to cry. I'm not going to cry. I did almost cry on 45 day when I did my set. I was getting quite emotional about that just because it was quite a long day, and obviously, you know, it being a long, long year and stuff. But it's you guys as well, you know, it's not just, you know, if it wasn't, for example, you know, Double P, you know, if he hadn't sort of opened up and talked to me about what was going on in sort of his life and how it affected, you know, I wouldn't have started part of my journey, and that's going on. And, you know, where I think that's.
But you facilitate and you put a lot into it, and it doesn't go unnoticed. So.
Yeah. No, thanks, guys. That's much appreciated. Right, I'm going to go quiet for a minute now, if you want to play your last track.
So this is, could we call it hip-hop? I guess it's hip-hop. Again, this was something I heard early on, really commercial. Quite a lot of people are a bit of a hater of it because it charted, I think. But this track to me, you know, you play this and people absolutely love it. It's a banger. So I'm just going to put it on and try not to rap badly to it.
Ha ha ha.
just try and keep my mouth shut, which is challenging at times. If I was a bit drunk now and I had a microphone, I would. This is my party piece. I paid a lot of money for that as well, but it's a banger. You could not love that.
It's so good, and it's one of those tracks I've certainly loved it for years and years and years. You have to get it in your collection. I know it may be pricey, but you might find one that's
You never know. I paid disgusting amounts of money for it, but I love it.
Okay, here's a challenge for you from Double P. Next time we meet up, this is being dropped, and you're going to rap.
Well, okay then, as long as you buy the gin, because that's a surefire way of me rapping.
If we get 45 Finch as well, it says, makes me play air bass like Alan Partridge.
Brilliant. Might distract off my terrible white woman rapping.
Just have the two of you at the front recreating that song, air bass and rapping. That sounds, I think.
The two West Country bumpkins, yeah.
Matt's going to borrow his girlfriend's copy.
No, you won't.
My instruments are so good, and party coming. Well, I mean, yeah, Double P. Yes, I think I know you've got your night going on, but I think next year, you know, there will be something hopefully bigger going on, and hopefully as many of us as possible will be able to meet up. You know, it's just a case of finding the right place that's going to let us play some cool music, and just work out where it's doing. You know, maybe 45 Finch is going to supply a bar full of gin. I think maybe we're heading down to 45 Finch's place then.
Awesome.
Sounds good. Yeah, is that enough for you, though, a bar full of gin?
Yeah, all right. To be fair, I was quite tame when we went out in Bristol. It was quite a tame.
It was, actually. I don't think I had that much to drink, actually. I had a few pints, but I didn't have a hangover on that. The right place is Edinburgh. I'm in talks with Scotty Boy, and there's something definitely going to happen there at some point soon.
I've never been, so perhaps we need to make a road trip.
Yeah, Edinburgh. I mean, I think apart from this time round, I hadn't been for like 25 years, but it's beautiful.
It looks amazing. Yeah,
amazing. And Double P's bringing his camper van.
So, awesome.
I'm not DJing records, but we have a camper festival down here, actually, which is quite good, a family thing, but I'm DJing at that, so I think Double P might come down for that. But anyone who's got a camper van might be worth doing that.
Got a motorhome, probably.
Well, yeah, they might let you in. Right, I'm gonna play one track because it's dropped today, and I think a lot of us have probably got it, and it's quite an important one, so let me just get that lined up, and then I'll drop it. Okay. All right. So a lot of us know of or have been following Del Sol Condor, obviously. And there's two 45s that have dropped. And this is the, I don't know if you can see that, actually. Maybe not. It's too bright. There you go. This is the fuck cancer one. Obviously, he's going through mouth cancer at the moment. He's in a hospice at the moment, which is quite sad. I don't know. You know how things are going to pan out, but this is Blade Chrome Filmos Chill specific, and it's produced by DJ Napa. So let's have a quick listen to this. Fuck cancer, cancer, fuck cancer, cancer, fuck cancer, cancer, fuck cancer.
cancer. Life changing, taking away all of my energy, it's life draining. I nearly lost my brother a couple of years back. We were told it was the end, he was looking really near that. But my bro was a fighter, he told me he had the answer. He stayed mentally strong and said, fuck cancer. There's really no way of knowing if it's coming, but the one thing I know is that it won't catch me running. Shout out to Dale, stick the middle finger up and fight it. You've given me the strength to face this first and write it. Fuck cancer.
So yeah, that is fuck cancer. I think quite a lot of people have managed to pick it up. But if you haven't, I don't know if there's any copies left of that one. But I think there's a couple of copies of RI4, which is the Living for the Day, which is the other one. Put that forward. But yeah, you know, give Del a shout. I think what he wants to do, if people have got copies of it, is get them holding copies up and taking photographs and posting it on Instagram, just so he's got all that. And yeah, big shout out to Del.
Love.
Thanks very much. It's been fun. We've got through seven, haven't we? I think we've got through seven. I haven't lost count.
Nope, you've done well.
That's cool. Thank you so much for being a guest and obviously being on and also on part of my journey as well, which was great to chat to you on that. And that's still up on the website and also on YouTube. A couple of things coming up, which includes you and some other people who are on that. I'm just going to put this out to the stream. Right, so that is so Coffee and Donuts is happening on Saturday, and we've got Mark Hype as a guest and Butchie B, and then Ace of Raids on Saturday. You're on that. Lady Melza, Fat Wax, Sideshow. Oh, God, it's going very quickly. I'm sorry. there we go. Let's start again. So Coffee and Donuts, Mark Hype, Butchie B, myself and Fat Wax 45, and Rob's having a week off. So we've got D Cow in. And then Ace of Raids on Saturday is yourself, Fat Wax 45, Sideshow, and DJ D Sync, who's making his debut on Ace of Raids. And then on next Monday is Part of My Journey, I think episode 12, and I've got Matt Love and also Funky Flavors joining us. So it's going to be an interesting show and always good fun with the 45s and the confectionery corner, but also talking about important and serious issues such as anxiety, etc. And Chris International is going to be our guest on the next show, and that is on the 19th of October, 2 weeks time. And yeah, I'm looking forward to maybe seeing his face, because he doesn't normally show his face on his streams. I'm gonna have to see if he's gonna do that or not. We might work a way around it, but we'll see. But right, I'm just gonna have a quick look and see who is live, and then we'll raid out to someone. Must always raid out. Let's have a look who's live. Let's go and see Andy Smith, actually. He was on 45 Raiders actually the other week. So yeah, right, controller works. Well, there we go. I think that's working. So that's going from there. So that's fine. Cool. Yeah, thanks again. It's been brilliant. Great chatting to you. If you hang on there in a minute when we raid out in the green room, as they say on Wednesdays on Wax. But yeah, thank you to everyone. Matt Love, 45 Finch, Double P, Chris International, T2 Funk, Scotty Boy. Who else do we have? Dinked, Kev was in earlier, and Paul Sitter, and yeah, everyone else who was in the chat. It's been great, great fun. And if anyone missed any of it or wants to watch it again, it will be up on the website, and the audio will be hopefully on Mixcloud. So I know a few people listened to last show on Mixcloud, but But yeah, anyway, thanks to everyone. Good night. We'll raid out to Andy Smith, and yeah, we'll speak soon.
Yeah, take care. Thank you so much. Big love.